Now we discuss the Bayes' theory of ferromagnetism. The ferromagnetic materials are similar to paramagnetic materials. They are having net magnetic moment, but the difference is that in paramagnetic materials, the adjacent magnetic dipoles are not having any mutual interaction, but in ferromagnetic materials, the dipoles are having mutual interaction. There exists an interaction between these adjacent magnetic dipoles, and that interaction is causing them to align in a specific direction. We assume that this mutual interaction between the adjacent between the dipoles, we can take it as equivalent to a magnetic field which is aligning these dipoles in a specific direction, and it can be written as that field can be written as exchange field. H is called exchange field, or this is the molecular field, or it is called Bayes' field. Actually, there is no such a field inside the ferromagnetic material, but there is a mutual interaction between different magnetic dipoles, and that interaction tending them to align in a specific direction. So we are taking that interaction as equivalent to a field which is called exchange field or Bayes' field, and we can assume this Bayes' field HE proportional to the magnetization. Actually, in a ferromagnetic material, when we take iron, a specific ferromagnetic material, the net magnetic moment, the whole system may not be having any net magnetic moment, but different parts of that system having magnetic moments aligned in specific direction. This region is having magnetic moment along this direction, some other region is having magnetic moment aligned in certain different direction. So like that, we will be having different regions which is having the alignment of magnetic dipoles in a specific direction. Overall, when we take the magnetic moment, it will be zero, but when we take a specific region, it will be having all the dipoles aligned in specific direction, and it will be having some it will be having magnetization. So this magnetization means this is the magnetization of a specific region. That regions are called domains. So this is the magnetization for a particular domain where the adjacent all the dipoles are interacting with each other. This can be SE can be proportional to, it can be written as proportional to the magnetization, or we can write HE is equal to a constant. I am taking the constant lambda into M. Here we are using SI system. This lambda is, in this case, H and M are having same dimension, so lambda is a dimensionless quantity in SI system, and it is independent of this constant. It is a constant which is independent of temperature. So this is the exchange field or Bayes' field that is causing the magnetic dipoles to align in a specific direction. This its magnitude is of the order of 10^7 gauss in ferromagnetic in iron. So its value is very high compared to the external magnetic field we are applying. So this field is called exchange field. And when we consider the paramagnetic susceptibility, I am representing it as chi p, that is, that can be written as the ratio of magnetization to magnetizing field. When we consider the magnetizing field, in this case, if we are applying an external magnetic field, then H will be the combination of HA is applied magnetizing field, and HE is the field, it is called an exchange field. H is exchange field. So the total field can be written as, total field that is causing magnetization in a specific direction can be written as H equal to HA plus HE. So this H we can write it as chi P is equal to M by H plus H. The ferromagnetic susceptibility can be written as, I am writing this chi. Chi is ferromagnetic susceptibility, which will be the ratio of magnetization to applied field. Actually, applied field is HA. So the ferromagnetic susceptibility is the ratio of magnetization to applied field. So M by HA is ferromagnetic susceptibility, and this ferromagnetic effect we are taking as a paramagnetic substance. In paramagnetic substance, the adjacent dipoles are not having any alignment in specific direction. They are randomly arranged. They are randomly arranged, and the net magnetic moment is zero. But with that individual magnetic moment in ferromagnetic substance, one additional field is there, that is exchange field, which is causing them to align in a specific direction. So when we consider the paramagnetic susceptibility, the total magnetization to total field, that total field we are taking as combination of applied field plus exchange field. Ferromagnetic susceptibility is ratio of magnetization to applied field, HA. IP, paramagnetic susceptibility, we know it is proportional to, inversely proportional to absolute temperature, or it is equal to C by T, where C is Curie constant, and T is absolute temperature. So substituting this chi P, C by T for chi P, and lambda M for HC, we can write this as chi P is equal to M by, instead of chi P we can write C by T is equal to M by HA, applied field plus HA is lambda M. Then cross multiplying this, we will get C HA plus C lambda M is equal to T into M. Then taking this term to right hand side, we can write it as CHA is equal to T, taking M as common, then we can write it as M into T minus C lambda. We know the susceptibility for ferromagnetic material as chi is equal to magnetization to applied magnetizing field. So it is equal to M by HA. When we calculate M by HA, from this equation we can write it as C by T minus C lambda. So this is the expression for susceptibility. Susceptibility is C by T minus C lambda, where lambda is constant and C is Curie constant and T is absolute temperature. So from this equation we know that When t equal to c lambda, there is a singularity. This term becomes 0, 1 by 0 is infinite. That means at t equal to c lambda, its ferromagnetism, if the temperature is beyond that, the ferromagnetism disappears and the material becomes paramagnetic. And below that, the material will be having magnetization in specific direction. That is called spontaneous magnetization. So this is the temperature below which the spontaneous magnetization exists in the material. So I am writing it as TC equal to C lambda, which is the temperature at which, temperature above which ferromagnetic material becomes paramagnetic, and below which the material is having spontaneous magnetization. Ferromagnetic materials are having spontaneous magnetization. So it will be ferromagnetic below the temperature T equal to TC. So this represents the variation of susceptibility with the temperature above the TC, above the Curie temperature TC. So this can also be written as chi proportional to T minus C lambda raised to minus 1, or chi proportional to T minus C lambda raised to minus gamma, where gamma equal to 1. Detailed calculations of susceptibility shows that the value of gamma is actually 1.33. So this equation is chi proportional to t minus e lambda raised to minus gamma. This equation, this is applicable, this variation is applicable when temperature is greater than Tc. If the temperature is less than Tc, then its susceptibility is given by chi proportional to Tc minus T the whole raised to beta, where beta is equal to 1 by 2. So this equation shows a singularity at T equal to Tc, and below this temperature it is having spontaneous magnetization, so the material will exist in ferromagnetic state. Above that temperature, the material will be existing in paramagnetic state, and this represents the variation when the temperature is above paramagnetic state. And instead of 1, detailed theory shows that its value is 1.33. So chi proportional to T minus E lambda raised to minus 1.33. And below that temperature, it is given by chi proportional to Tc minus T raised to beta, where beta equal to 1 by 2. So this equation is called Curie-Wiis law. This is called Curie-Wiis law. According to Heisenberg model, the interaction energy due to the spin motion of adjacent dipoles can be written as U is equal to minus 2je Si dot Sj, where Si we can write it as Uij, or total interaction energy on the ith dipole can be written as sigma j minus 2 je Si dot Sj. So this equation represents the interaction energy between two adjacent dipoles. So this is the ith dipole, which is having spin in on specific direction. This is jth dipole. So the interaction on ith dipole is due to all the dipoles present near the ith dipole. But we need to take the contribution from all the dipoles in a specific domain. But in practical case, only the dipoles near this ith dipole will be having interaction with this ith dipole. So we only need to calculate the interaction of dipoles situated near this ith dipole for calculating the interaction energy of that particular dipole. So this represents their own term is J is called exchange integral, where J is called exchange. This is not angular momentum quantum number. It is called the exchange integral, and that exchange integral, this exchange integral that depends on the overlap of charge distribution of nearby electrons. So if the nearby atoms are separated by far away distance, then J will be different. If the overlap is high, then the J will be different for different separation between the ions. Then overlap of charge distribution, the J depends on the overlap of charge distribution between the adjacent ions. Now consider the variation of exchange integral. Y-axis we are taking exchange integral, and the X-axis we are taking the ratio A by R. A is the separation between adjacent ions. Separation between the adjacent ions, and ratio. This is R is the radius of a particular ion. A is separation between them, and R is the radius of a particular ion. That ratio, when we draw the variation of exchange integral with this ratio, we will get a graph like this. So this ratio, this exchange integral is negative for materials like manganese, chromium, etc. It is positive for iron, nickel, cobalt, then gadolinium, etc. For these materials, the exchange integral here J is positive, and for these materials J is negative. Slater showed that this exchange integral is positive when this ratio A by R is greater than or equal to 3. It is greater than or equal to 3. That means this exchange integral depends on the ratio A by R. A is the separation between the ions, and R is the between the atoms, and R is the radius of particular atom. So that exchange integral J is a factor which depends on the separation between the ions, which depends on the overlap of charge distribution between different ions. Si is the spin of ith dipole, and Sj is the spin of jth dipole. Now consider the case with the ferromagnetic materials such as iron, nickel, cobalt, etc. For that, the exchange integral J is positive. If J is positive, for a stable system, the energy should be minimum. For getting minimum energy, for getting, it should be negative. So if J is positive, then Si dot Sj should be S square. It should be plus S square. Then this energy will be minimum. Then it will be in stable state. That means ferromagnetic material, to make the exchange energy minimum, Si dot Sj should be S square. It should be positive. Positive means they should align along the same direction. If these two are aligning along the same direction, then S dot Sj will be S square. So in ferromagnetic material, the tendency of adjacent dipole is to align in a specific direction. Now, we will study the case with the antiferromagnetic material. Using this equation, we can say that the antiferromagnetic material, actually the exchange integral is negative. For antiferromagnetic material, exchange integral is negative. So this is negative, and here on negative is there, so it is positive. That means to make the energy negative, minimum, Sa and Sj should be in opposite direction. So in antiferromagnetic material, the tendency of adjacent dipole is to align in opposite direction. In ferromagnetic material, they will align in specific direction. So in a domain, here all the dipoles are aligning in one specific direction, so we are having a net magnetic moment. I am taking it in this direction. Here the dipoles are aligning in some other direction. Net magnetic moment I am drawing here. This region is having, let it be the net magnetic moment be along this direction, and this region, let this net magnetic moment is along this direction. So it will be in the total magnetic moment of system will be zero. Instead of actually, based on that Heisenberg model, all the tendency of all the dipole is to align in a specific direction. If all the dipoles are aligned in a specific direction, if all individual dipoles are aligned in a specific direction, we will be having a net magnetic moment in the region, and we will be having a magnetic energy. The system will be having a magnetic energy which is given by half H dot B. The magnetic energy per unit volume, actually it is energy density, it is given by half H dot B. So if all the dipoles are aligned in a specific direction, its magnetic energy will be very high. That means it will again go to unstable state. For stable system, there will be minimum energy. So there will be a balance between exchange energy and magnetic energy. So to reduce the magnetic, as all the dipoles are aligning along a specific direction, there is a tendency of increase of magnetic energy. So to decrease the magnetic energy, the region will divide into different parts and the adjacent parts. If this region is having dipoles aligned in specific direction, and the nearby region, they will be aligning in some other direction, such that the net magnetic moment, the net magnetic field will decrease if different regions are having magnetic moment in different directions. So by dividing a complete region into certain specific region having alignment in different directions, we can reduce the magnetic energy. That's why they, instead of having all the dipoles aligned in specific direction, we will be having regions where the net magnetic moment is not equal to zero. Such regions are called domains. So domains are formed to minimize the magnetic energy, and there a balance is maintained between the exchange energy and the magnetic energy. Also, there is anisotropy energy. There are certain regions where we can easily magnetize, and certain regions are there. There the magnetization in that direction is difficult. So that energy difference is called anisotropy energy. That determines the boundary of these two regions. Actually, all of a sudden this magnetic moment is not changing to here. So it will be gradually changing from one specific magnetization to magnetization in another direction. So there will be dipoles, they are changing from one region. There will be a wall separating these two dipoles. In that wall, the magnetic moment will be continuously changing from one region to another region. That is determined by the balance between anisotropy energy and the exchange energy. So that's why these domains are formed. And now, if I take the total magnetic moment of system, it will be zero, since the domains are aligned in different directions. They are randomly oriented, and hence the total magnetic moment of system will be zero. Now, if I take this material in an external magnetic field, if I keep this material in an external magnetic field, if I am keeping here B is equal to zero, so the net magnetic moment of system, here M represents the total magnetic moment of system, that is equal to zero. Now I apply a magnetic field, then the domains along the direction of magnetic field will grow, and domains opposite, which is having magnetic moment opposite to the direction of magnetic direction of external field, will its magnetization, its magnetic moment will decrease. So this will grow at the expense of domains aligned in opposite direction. That means in the boundary, near the boundary, this will align, the dipoles near the boundary will tend to align along the direction of external magnetic field. That means if more and more atomic dipoles are aligning along the direction of external field, then the domain with the magnetic moment along the direction of external field, its size, domain size will increase. So this is having magnetic moment along the direction of external field, and this is having magnetic moment opposite to the direction of external field. So this domain size will decrease, and this domain size will increase. That means the domains having magnetic moment along the direction of external field will grow at the expense of domains aligned in opposite direction. When the strength of magnetic field is increased very much, then one more thing will happen. These domains can also have a rotation. If high magnetic field is applied, these domains will rotate along the direction of external field. If they are rotating along the direction of external field, then this domain, initially it is having moment along this direction. Now it is rotating, its moment is rotating along this direction. Then it will be having a component along this direction. This moment, since it is perpendicular, it is not having any component along this direction. But when the moment is rotating along the direction of field, then it will be having a component along this direction. So in this case also, the magnetic moment along the direction of external field will increase. Now we will draw the variation of magnetization with the applied field. That variation is called hysteresis loop. So y-axis, along the y-axis we are taking magnetization, and along the x-axis we are taking applied field. This is applied field, and this is magnetizing field, and here I am taking magnetization. Instead of magnetization, you can take the total magnetic field inside the material also along the y direction. You can take also B. Earlier I drawn there B. Actually, that is not B. It is magnetizing field. Yes. So when we draw the variation of magnetization with the magnetizing field, initially when we increase the external field, the domains along the direction of field will grow. That growth is given by this one. So very low magnetic field in this region, they are reversible. If I remove the magnetic field at this point, then it will reach the starting point. So this region here, it is reversible. Then if I increase further, then the more and more atomic dipoles will be aligning along the direction of external field. So this is irreversible. If it is increased beyond a limit, then it is irreversible. Then after growing, one more tendency is there. One more thing can happen. The domain can also have a rotation along the direction of field. That is happening at a high applied field. So the field is increased beyond a limit, then the domain rotation will happen, and the maximum moment is produced along the direction of external field. So this represents the saturation point. Now if I decrease the applied field, then it is not following the same path. It will follow a path like this. So when the field is reduced to zero, the magnetization inside the material is not equal to zero. It will be having some magnetic moments along the direction of external field. Here some irreversible part is there. So if it is irreversible, then it will retain some magnetic field inside the material, and this is called remanence or retentivity. So when the applied field is reduced to zero, some field will be retained inside the material. Now I change the field to negative side. If magnetizing field is applied in negative side, then this field will reduce to zero. This point is called coercivity. Coercivity is the field applied in opposite direction, negative direction, to make the field inside the material zero. So in negative side, if I increase the field, the same loop, a similar loop will be getting in negative side. Then it will be like this. So this is not following. If we increase the magnetic field and decrease the field, they are not following the same path. We will be getting a loop. That delay is called the hysteresis. So this represents the hysteresis loop. Here it is domain rotation. So this represents the variation of magnetization with the magnetizing field, and this represents the hysteresis loop for a ferromagnetic material.